Well, hi everyone. I'm John Rethlin with a retro review of TNA Hard Justice 2005. A little bit of a background. I love TNA back at this point. Now, that's not to say I don't like a lot of the talents that are there now. I just don't have time to watch the current product. But I would argue that from 04 to 09, yes, with some dips, the product that TNA, now Impact Wrestling, was putting out was as good, if not better, than what WWE was putting out. And 2005 was a particular peak year for TNA. And this was all built around AJ Styles trying to end Jeff Jarrett's Reign of Terror, his stranglehold on the NWA World Heavyweight Championship. And thankfully he did, because I think the fans might have rioted if he hadn't. But there was an undercard before that main event, which is the point of an undercard, because if it was after the main event, then it wouldn't be the fucking main event. But that aside, we start with a 10-bell salute to Chris Candido. Very nice gesture, easy for me to say. He was managing the Naturals at the time, even helped them win the NWA World Tag Team Championships. It was a nice tribute to him, and there would be a little bit of a tribute later, and a pretty good tag team title match to, right in about the middle of the show. And we have Don West, Mike Tenay on commentary. I always thought they were an underrated duo. I thought their energy was very infectious, and they were quite good. We have Petey Williams and Eric Young versus Sonny Siaki and Apollo. It was power versus agility. This wasn't bad, but this very much was basically felt like a pre-show match. They just had to open up the show. And I'm not saying that the talent wasn't main card ready. Quite the opposite. They are all quite good. But this felt kind of almost like a thrown together match. You had Siaki and Apollo that formed a team out of mutual respect. And Williams and Eric Young were part of Team Canada. So, eventually, there was a ref distraction. A1, Alistair Ralph, runs in, hits a jackhammer variation, and Williams gets the cover for 3. So, there you go. Team Canada gets a victory. And Team Canada would kind of be all over this goddamn show. The announcers kill time and hype up the rest of the card, and then we get Chris Sabin and Tracy Brooks versus Michael Shane, or Matt Bentley. He had a lot of names there. And Trinity. Actually, I think he only had 2, but they switched them a lot because they had to dub them over. I think because of the Shane twins. That's why they had to change Michael Shane. Despite the fact he'd been using that name before, but whatever. This was built around Tracy and Matt Bentley, Michael Shane, being at odds and everything, and they picked respected people to team with them. Match is okay. The women actually did some pretty good spots. Tracy and Trinity did some good stuff, including getting up on the ramp, the ramps to the ring. in the impact zone, the old impact zone, and doing some good stuff. Sabin and Michael Shane doing some very nice wrestling. Tracy then eventually low blows Sabin, a kick to Trinity from Michael Shane, and then he covers Sabin for 3. Oh no, it turns out it was all a ruse and everything, so it was a 10.5-minute match just to convince everybody, to convince everybody otherwise and then prove it was just a fucking ruse at the end. Which, whatever, this probably could have been saved for Impact, but at least it was nice that they got featured on pay-per-view. And Tracy, I think that she actually deserves a little bit more respect. I mean, she was never a world beater in the ring, but did improve. And Trinity, super agile as well. So, we have a Team Canada promo, basically to kill time, talk about stuff, people being in the Battle Royal and stuff like that, and their dominant win earlier. Then we have Dusty Rhodes talking to Tito Ortiz, who's going to be the referee for the main event of AJ Styles versus Jeff Jarrett. Then we have Jeff Hardy, no-showing this event, and Raven talks about him and mentions X-Pac, even though he was supposed to be called Sean Waltman, because X-Pac was owned by WWE, but whatever. Raven then says he's a human cancer, da-da-da-da-da, he's going to get his respect. He would actually win the NWA World Heavyweight Championship at Slammiversary just about a month later. Actually, about 3 weeks later. And then we have the House of Fun match. It's Raven versus Sean Waltman, and there were a lot of weapons and everything. There was even a cage wall part that would factor into the finish. This wasn't bad. I'm not the biggest fan of hardcore wrestling, honestly. I mean, I have my reasons for that, and not because of it being gratuitous violence. I just don't feel it's personally wrestling. But there are times that people can work a match around it. Raven made his home there. Sean Waltman didn't look out of place at all. There were a lot of weapons. Raven got busted open. Waltman got busted open afterwards. There was trash can lid stuff, can you do the can? He was just hitting him over the head, Raven was. And there was a dive through the table, and then Waltman later got hurled off the little staging ramp area through a table, but only got 2. There was, some handcuffs brought out, and he was handcuffed around the ring post. And Raven's caning him and saying, are you quit? Do you quit? It's like, give me more. It's like, oh, you stupid son of a bitch. This kind of stuff. You stupid idiot. No. A staple gun was brought out. Ouch. I don't know why. And then what happens is they, Raven does a back body drop, like throws Waltman into the cage wall that immediately falls. It was a gimmick to fall over, but it falls over, and he pins him on the cage wall that has just conveniently fallen to where it's like laying, you know, like on a slant from the ring apron to the floor. And he covers Waltman for three. Surprise match, definitely not that bad. And the right man won because, well, A, Raven, again, would win the world championship a little bit later. And also, Waltman had no reason to win this. He was being brought in basically as a stopgap, but would stick in Impact for a little bit longer. We then get a video package going over the whole thing with Three Live Crew and the Outlaw, a.k.a. Kip James, because the Outlaw was a little bit too close to home for the New Age Outlaws. And it was like between BG James and Kip James, were they going to be able to, you know, were they going to come to blows? You know, former tag team partners and everything, Crew, you know, Conan and Truth wondering, where is your head at? Not Basement Jacks, not that. The song's in your head, though, though now, isn't it? We think of Monty Brown and Kip James versus DDP and Ron Killings, so, and Ron the Truth Killings. Look, this was built around DDP and Monty Brown at first having a mutual respect, and then Monty Brown cost DDP the chance to win the World Heavyweight Championship, and then they build up this. This would be DDP's, I believe, last appearance in TNA, because I think they were just going to job him out, basically, which at that stage of his career, he probably didn't need to do that, and really, they weren't going to use him all that well afterwards. He was just brought in basically to have a few matches, get built up, and then be fed to Jeff Jarrett. Like a lot of former WCW guys, former WCW guys, yeah, he did that to Nash, he did that to DDP, and then beat a homegrown guy like Monty Brown. Monty Brown should have been world champion, just saying. This team of two big guys, Phi Delta Slam, they show up and they weren't really all that impressive, and they try to take down DDP. They take him down for a little bit, but then Diamond Cutter to one, and then Diamond Cutter off the top to the bigger one, and then a pounce, a pounce hit DDP. He got pinned. There we go. So then we get an interview with the Naturals about Chris Candido and their career rebirth and how they dedicate this match to Chris Candido's memory. And then we get AMW, America's Most Wanted. Cowboy James Storm, Wildcat Chris Harris versus Naturals, Chase Stevens and Andy Douglas. Very underappreciated tag team. Always loved the Naturals. Really thought that they deserved. I mean, they got a lot of good moments here and they got a pretty good title run out of this. But I always thought they deserved a little bit more after they had lost tag team championships in October of 2005. They should have gotten a chance to get back at them, but it just seemed like then they were kind of seemingly buried down, and then they were managed by Shane Douglas. That went fucking nowhere, but anyway. So they dedicate this to Chris Candido, crowd chants for Chris Candido. And they always have good matches. This was no exception. Very physical match, some chair usage, some very good stuff. Battle all over the impact zone, the staging area. was given a lot of time. They did a Tower of Doom spot because, of course, they did. And Chris Candido was known sometimes for cheating and winning by any means necessary. So I believe it was Chase Stevens that got the victory with a roll-up and his feet on the ropes. So they honor Chris Candido and keep the tag team championships and we keep them for another few months. Then we get Christopher Daniels versus Shocker. X Division title. And look, I love Christopher Daniels. Really, I do. Got to meet him a couple times. Great guy. Great fucking guy. Great fucking talent. The fact that he's almost 50 and can do that shit is a miracle. Shocker is good in the ring, but just something, or at least was good in the ring at this point. I don't know if he's still wrestling. Something just didn't click for me. I just didn't feel drawn to, like, really appreciate anything. Except, okay, he can do some flippy shit, and he can wrestle, but I don't really care about the guy. He didn't really have a defined character. Just something about him seemed off. The match was fine. Daniels did win with the Super Angels wings off the top, but it went a couple minutes longer, I think, than it needed to. But Daniels did get a good match out of Shocker, and Shocker pulled his weight, but I don't know. Something about this didn't click with me, but it wasn't a bad match at all. And then a Gauntlet for the Gold, Battle Royal, 20 men, and I'm just going to run through all the guys. I'm not going to go through all the spots, but a lot of it was based around Team Canada dominating at some points, because you had Bobby Roode, or Robert Roode, Bobbert Roode, Zach Gowan, yes, the one-legged man in an ass-kicking contest that actually did pretty well for a few minutes, Eric Young, Cassidy Riley, Elix Skipper, Shark Boy, A1, Chris Sabin, Petey Williams, Sonny Siaki, Lance Hoyt, Michael Shane, Matt Bentley, Jarrell Clark, Mr. 630, Mikey Batts, Kip James, Triton, Ron Killings, Apollo, BG James, and Abyss. You notice how almost half that field already worked? They already worked that previously in the night. This kind of reminded me of what they did with Bound for Glory later in the year when, you know, Nash couldn't answer the call because of either it was a heart condition stat. I think it was a heart. I think it was like, you know, a worry, a heart worry or an injury. But they had to do a gauntlet match and have Rhino win it after Rhino had already worked the Monsters Ball match. But anyway, the match was fine. You did get some good stuff like Sabin and Williams. Well, Sabin and Bentley, rather, attacking each other. And you got some good work in here, but it came down to Abyss and Ron Killings. A lot of chair usage and everything, but eventually Black Hole Slam, 1, 2, 3. And Abyss wins a World Heavyweight Championship shot. That would take a while to be cashed in on. Well, actually, I think he would get a shot at Raven. But anyway, this match was fine. I'm a sucker for Battle Royals, and it was good for what it was. We then get AJ Styles versus Jeff Jarrett, NWA World Heavyweight Championship match. Tito Ortiz as the referee and had a big fight feel. Had some good stuff with it. These two always work well together. The problem is, seen one Jarrett match, seen them all. Jeff Jarrett was a mid-card guy, never a main event guy. I get why he put himself in the main event here, but it got to the point where people were sick of him. They were beyond sick of him. They would have rioted had AJ Styles not won. And, you know, Monty Brown tries to interfere. He pounces Jarrett. There's this one point where Tito Ortiz is yelling at Monty Brown. It looks like AJ's got the victory over Jarrett. And then he's yelling at Tito to get back in the ring. You know, Tito Ortiz, UFC, Bellator, MMA guy. You know, really was hot at this point as far as his career and everything. And then Jarrett, you know, punching Styles in the corner. And not listening to ref's instructions, so Tito pulls him down, and he shoves Tito, punch, and then spiral tap from AJ, 1, 2, 3, crowd roars. AJ Styles is the new NWA World Heavyweight Champion for about 3 weeks. Seriously, about 3 weeks. I think by Slammiversary, he lost it, and, you know, it's like, and he didn't get another title run for a while. For being the golden guy, for being the golden boy, so to speak, kind of mix up words there. He didn't get as many world title runs as you might have thought. I mean, he got a couple runs with the NWA world title, but I feel that Styles deserved almost a little more. He was always in the mix, but just something was a little bit off about that. But that being said, he beat Jeff Jarrett, beat the Reign of Terror, and Jeff Jarrett would then hold the championship again after beating Raven, and then lose it to Rhino, Bound for Glory 05, win it back a couple days later, then lose it to Christian Cage, that is, against All Odds 06, then would win it back at Slammiversary 06, and then would lose it to Sting at Bound for Glory 2006, and thankfully would never hold the NWA World Championship again, mainly because the NWA World Championship, you know, the disbanding between TNA and the NWA happened like around May of 2007. But anyway, that's enough history right there. So what do you guys think of this event? Let me know in the comments. Like, share, subscribe. Twitter handle in the description. I'm Jarrett Ritlin. I'll see you soon.